She is the one that put all of this together.
I don't know how many of you have, well, I know some of you that have had community theater experience, and one person's gonna do it all today. Okay, so we have already had all the housekeeping things. I want you to know that masks are optional. It's your comfort level, or if you feel like you have something that for some reason that somebody else may feel uncomfortable, it's just entirely up to you. So good evening. It's good to see all of you. Glad that you're here. We have a chance to laugh tonight. Or in this case, maybe both. Both would be really good. A lot of both would be even better. So feel free, if it's funny to you, have at it. Just laugh all you want. We will have a 15-minute intermission about halfway through. And what we are doing at this point is I'm going to introduce you to my crew. They're awesome. Assistant leader, Girl Scouts just comes back. Assistant Director Melinda Bass. So just watch with her hands. They're just going to wave at you.
Oh, okay.
Or maybe she's not. I don't. There she is. And always Assistant Leader Laura Collins. Props. Well, my husband Dennis and I do props, but we also had an assistant today, Layla. And then I always like to thank Mr. Carl and Ms. Virginia for allowing us to do this. Now then, there is a sheet of paper over there on the table that you would think would be completely correct, but that's not even a possibility at this point. We have changed the date of this particular play 3 times. We don't know what it's going to take to get all of those things done, but we can guarantee you that if you buy a season ticket, you will get your money's worth out of season. Not going to not let you do things because it maybe goes over the year. Okay. So, but pick it up. The only thing on here that is not correct as of this moment would be the very first item, and that is the Variety Night Musical fundraiser, which we wanted to be sure that we would have time to prepare since we've moved along so many times. We want to be sure that we have time to prepare a really premium program for you. So, look forward to that. So now, join us in London and just sit back and let us entertain you. Thank you.
What's all this?
Never mind them entities, Medkins. What's this foolish girl been blathering about now?
Begging your pardon, Vigilant Duke, sir. I just never worked in such a large, spooky place before, and when the agency...
Spooky? How dare you? Margate Manor has been in my family for countless generations.
All right, then. Oh, it's spooky. Give me the safety of your life, but it will alter the facts.
Now, see here, young lady. Oh, blast the guest of you. Medkins.
At once, sir.
As for you, young lady, you could thank heaven the guest arrived so opportunely for you. Now there's no time for me to hire a new girl.
As if you could get one. I'll just go see about the hors d'oeuvres.
That's hors d'oeuvre.
I'm worrying as I live and breathe. You haven't offered in 20 years.
I'm afraid you have the advantage of me, sir.
Barnaby, Barnaby Falsey. Have I changed so much?
Barnaby, of course. Now I recognize you. Of course, you were a merry lad in school the last time I saw you, and you certainly didn't have those mutton chop side whiskers and that mustache.
That's true enough, I dare say. I does the time fly.
Oh, it does indeed, indeed. But it's splendid having you home again. How was your trip?
A little rough halfway over, but otherwise quite pleasant. Mm. It was nice of you to send me that plane ticket. It's a little rough being a poor member of an otherwise wealthy family.
Sherry?
Sir?
Mr. Lee.
Thank you, Mickey.
Splendid idea. It is getting a bit chilly in here.
And it's getting a little bit shorter as well.
Yes, it is a bit dim in here at that. Medkins?
At once, sir.
Ah, that's much better. Come along, Barnaby. Let's have our sherry by the fire.
Will there be anything else for you tonight, sir?
Not for the moment, Medkins. But thank you. Please keep an eye out for the arrival of the rest of my guests.
Yes, sir.
Must be nice to have a service. Just say the word and it's done. How long has Medkins been with you?
Well, as a matter of fact, and it's most embarrassing, I only hired him for the duration of the house party. And a young snip of a maid named Magnolia. They both arrived yesterday morning.
Oh, I thought.
You see, my boys, the blasted taxes. No one runs a mansion as they did in the old days. Can't afford it, you see. Servants are hard to come by. Good servants, nearly impossible to come by. And in either case, it's beastly expensive to keep them around.
Then how do you take such care of such a large place without them?
Oh, I don't. I only open up this wing for the party. Actually, I stay in a few small rooms in the other wing normally. No need for a domestic staff or anything that size now, is there?
No, I don't suppose there is, but I thought that the Duke family was absolutely balling in money.
Oh, afraid not, afraid not. Just a paltry few million pounds is all. And when that's gone... Oh, my sister-in-law.
Is that Herman's widow? Ah, Lady Barbara Flanders, is it not?
Oh, no. Aren't you going to introduce me?
Barbara, this is your nephew-in-law, Barnaby Falsey from the United States.
Happy to meet you, Mr. Tate.
Falsey, Lady Barbara.
Now, you mustn't flatter me.
She's deaf as a post. I should have warned you. Hardly catches a word of a conversation.
Oh, really? I have many friends there.
Where?
Why, a conversation, of course. How long have you lived there?
Barbara, I didn't say conversation, I said conversation.
Yes, but how long has he lived there?
Oh, ever so long.
So long? You're not leaving already.
Barbara, we were just having some sherry. Would you like a glass?
Miss Michael's class. That's where I know him from. Yes. Didn't you love it? The bright lights, the applause.
No, Oh, no, Barbara. He has nothing to do with your amateur theatricals. This is Barnaby Folsom, my only boy's brother. I mean, my only brother's boy. Your brother-in-law, son.
Oh, happy to meet you, Mr. Lawson.
Really, Lady Barbara. It's no use, Barnaby. Once she gets a wrong notion in her head, there's no disabusing her of it. From now on, she'll insist you two met while sharing a class.
Sharing a glass? How else would I drink it?
That's one nice thing about Barbara. Sooner or later, the proper message gets through. In a roundabout way, of course. More guests! Capital! Capital!
Sir, Miss Rosalind Barstow.
What?
Oh, Orion, darling. I heard you were having a party and I simply couldn't stay away.
Blast, Rosalind. This is a family gathering.
Well, I practically am family. Anyway, it's only a moment. A little bit of time.
Miss Rosalind Barstow, my nephew, Barnaby Folsom. Rosalind is a friend. Well, hardly Barnaby Dash at all. I'm old enough to be her
husband.
A
magnolia, must you?
Must I what, sir?
Oh, never mind, never mind. Just go into the hall and see about the guest baggage.
No. That's out of maid's work. I was hired as a party maid.
Well, we may move the party upstairs, so get to it.
So, Miss Cleo Barton and friend.
The Cleo Barton? The Hollywood movie star?
Oh, really?
Oh, Orion! Lady Barbara, I hope it's been ages and ages!
Orion, is that Cleo Barton?
That's what Merkin said, my dear.
What about Merkin's head?
Oh, Orion, darling. Oh, it was such a long, dreary ride up here. Isn't anyone going to offer me a drink?
It must have been a long and dreary ride up here. Is anybody going to offer them a drink?
You'll have to excuse me.
See, damn as a post.
Magnolia.
Oh, you told me so yourself.
Hard to get competent help anymore, Mr.
Oh, Orion, how stupid of me. I'd like for you to meet, actually. I'd like for all of you to meet one of my oldest and dearest friends, Mr. Jeff. Mr. Jeff.
Barnett?
Barnett, yes.
Actually, we just met tonight.
Oh, well, actually. Some friendships seem as if they've gone on forever, you know. I knew the moment I met him that we had so much in common.
We met in a bar.
A pub, dear. A pub. That Jeff is an American.
Cleo, aren't you going to introduce your young man?
See? Jeff as a host.
Magnolia. Shouldn't you be seeing to the baggage?
There are 6 suitcases here. I can't carry more than 2.
Well, then make 3 trips.
But how do I know which bag you're supposed to go in?
Oh, which room is closest to Mr. O'Dukes?
Rosalind, you brought baggage. You weren't even invited to the house, let alone the bedrooms.
Well, it's only a matter of time, darling.
Now you say, Darrow, it's quite simple. Miss Barstow's in the blue room, Miss Barton's in the green room, and Mr. Folsey's in the gray room.
But I don't know which bag goes to who!
Oh, listen, why don't we carry our own luggage to our rooms? It would simplify things enormously.
That's horrible, aren't you?
Oh, if only servants weren't so beastly hard to get a hold of.
Shame on you.
I document to get a hold of from an agency. I say, did you just say carry our own baggage upstairs? That is to say, you brought overnight things too?
Well, of course he did, Orion. I mean, you can't expect the gentleman to stay all weekend without a change of underclothes.
Well, no, of course not. Naturally, it's just that, well, you said you met in a pub, so naturally, he just happened to have his baggage with him.
Well, actually, it was more of an inn. I was in the bar trying to get a room for the night, but they were all booked up, so...
So I told him that I knew of an absolutely divine place where he could stay the entire weekend and it wouldn't cost him a shilling.
Meaning here?
Oh, well, of course, darling. I mean, you have all this room, and it's much too late to be asking him to go somewhere else anyway, so...
Cleo, I wasn't going to evict the gentleman. I was just merely taking him away.
Oh, more guests. How can he? Do you think he'll have enough beds?
You know, I'm not certain. We may have to double up.
Oh, think of my reputation, darling.
Perhaps that's what decided him.
Maybe some of us could stay in the inn.
Oh, nonsense. I don't mind sharing a room if I need to.
She probably has a doctor's note.
Look, as an unexpected arrival, I don't want to impose.
Oh, I'm sure that Cleo was perfectly serious.
But as an uninvited guest, I...
Well, don't worry, my kids. I'm an uninvited guest myself.
Was that the doorbell?
I see what you mean. Sooner or later,
she catches up with events.
So, Miss Bond's there.
Oh, dear, not another bag! I beg your pardon.
I'm sorry, my lady. She means your luggage.
As if I didn't have anything more to carry up the stairs.
Which reminds me, Magnolia, haven't you better get started? Come in, Bobby. Come in. You look a bit chilly.
Yes, I am. I believe there is a storm brewing outside.
Oh dear, I just waxed and polished the Bentley, are you sure?
Well, the sky was filled with absolutely red clouds as I strolled up from the cottage.
Cottage?
Oh, Dasher. Well, I forgot you two had it met. Miss Barnsdale is a retired member of our staff. She was my grandniece Dora's governess. She uses a small cottage at the foot of the estate. This is Jeffrey Barnaby.
Orion, it is considered good manners for the gentleman to be introduced to the lady first, and then the lady to the gentleman?
Oops, sorry. If you haven't guessed already, Barnsley was my governess, too.
Is that all you're going to tell me about him?
That's all I know.
Oh, Cleo picked him up in a pub.
It's not as bad as it sounds.
It's worse? How delicious!
You mustn't say how deep, even if he is an American.
He must be improving. However did you know of his nationality?
He's gnashing what? So much for my treatment. Well, Beauty Rosalind, how did she know?
Lucky guess, I suppose. Probably the cut of my clothing.
Oh,
you know, I don't know about you, but I'd really like to know how did she know?
Oh, you know, I bet you I do know.
I bet you it's because you came with me. And she must think he's one of those American movie stars.
That's yes, he's seen in the pictures.
Yep.
I believe Orange is right. There does seem to be a storm brewing out there.
Perhaps we should close the garden doors.
No need. There's a considerable overhang of the terrace from the roof. No danger of any rain getting in. Besides, a good downpour would freshen up the place a bit. These old unused rooms do get a little bit musty.
Oh, darling, I've never seen this part of the house before. Perhaps you can give me a tour of the premises?
Not now, Rosalind. Maybe after the rest of the guests arrive. It wouldn't be good manners.
Never argue deportments with Barnes. She's quite right. Besides, I must be here when we're all gathered together to make my announcement.
Announcement, Uncle?
I thought there was an ulterior motive for this gathering. Oh, how wonderful. It sounds dreadfully mysterious.
Just how many more guests were you expecting, Mr. LeDuc?
Only one. My grandniece, Dora. When she's here, the party will be complete.
Perhaps that's her.
Not like her to be tardy.
She does have quite a long ways to come.
Didn't she immigrate to America?
Dover.
Oh, but I thought...
He doesn't mean the White Cliffs. He means the other one.
What other one?
In Delaware is the capital city.
I say, how did you know that?
The capital of Delaware is hardly secret information.
I mean, it's my granny settled there. How did you know that?
Why, you just told me.
Oh, don't be so jumpy, Orion. It was a perfectly obvious conclusion.
Yes, yes, I dare say it was.
How long ago did little Dora immigrate to America? It seems ages ago.
Oh, years and years. She was a mere child at the time. I don't suppose she'll recognize any of us. Except perhaps Barnsley. Teachers do seem to stick with one for some reason. The rest of us will undoubtedly be like strangers to her.
Oh, but Orion, you forget. I am a stranger to her. And so is Jeffrey here.
Ah, but not Barnaby. Certainly she'll remember him.
Why should she particularly remember me?
Well, Barnaby, my dear fellow, surely you remember. Taking her piggyback riding all over the estate. A child doesn't forget something like that. She'll know your face in a minute.
Well, not if he took her piggyback. Oh, she should definitely remember the back of his head.
Excuse me, sir, I do believe it's time to be getting to dinner.
What did catch me already?
You did say sharply at 8.
Where does the time go? Oh, well, if we must, we must.
But certainly we won't start without little Dora.
And why not? If she's going to be late, let her eat her dinner cold. As much as it pains me to say this, I agree with Cleo.
Very well then, we'll all go to dinner.
Magnolia, why don't you leave these here so that we may serve dinner?
Oh, those are my bags. I'll take care of them. Any particular room you wish me to occupy, Mr. LeDuc?
Gold room is ready for occupancy, I believe.
That'll be upstairs, first door to your right.
Here, those look heavy. Let me give you a hand.
Where were you when I need help?
Man, you owe your ribbon.
Thank you, Barbie.
Come on. That sherry's giving me an appetite. Isn't it dinner time yet?
Perhaps we should all write our remarks down on idiot cards and show them to the old girl. Cards.
Before dinner. Perhaps afterwards, my dear. That is, if everyone likes to play bridge.
Will someone please kindly take her by the arm and lead her to the table? I'm not up to explaining things to her in words.
I certainly hope she doesn't think she's being kidnapped.
I've already had my nap here.
Shall we then?
I guess I'll just walk into dinner unescorted.
Oh, Bonzi, don't be a social fuss, would you? Come along, though, girl, come along.
Oh, Orion, what are we having for dinner tonight?
Oh, the usual fare. Boiled mutton, Yorkshire pudding, and gooseberry chive.
Oh, you're all America, the home of the brave.
Yeah.
mysterious.
Another guest? I didn't hear the door chimes.
I came in through the garden. It was such a lovely night. I decided to walk across the fields from the station.
Lovely night? It's cold and damp and threatening to rain.
That's what I love about England. You can always rely on the weather.
I don't think you've had the pleasure.
Oh, British weather's never a pleasure. But it's so typical.
I mean, we haven't met, have we?
I suppose I should do the honors. Barnaby Folsey, Dora Dunstock.
Do you know? I used to have a relative by that name, Barnaby Folsey. I mean, not Dora Dunstock. I'm Dora Dunstock.
Darling, I think Barnaby knows which of you is which.
Dora, it's so nice to see you again.
Again?
Darling, Barnaby is that relative of yours.
He can't be. Barnaby was ever so much taller. He used to take me piggyback all over the estate.
Dora, you were barely 3 years old at the time. Naturally, I was taller.
How much taller were you? You can't have shrunk.
Of course not, darling, but you've grown.
Oh, that must be it. But why don't I recognize your whiskers?
I didn't have them then. I was hardly more than a young lad myself.
What do you mean, yourself? I certainly wasn't a young lad.
Really, darling, let's not pursue the matter.
Really? I say, that's the third time you've called her that.
Called me what?
Darling.
How dare you? I hardly know you.
Dora, he was merely quoting me. He was wondering how I could have called you darling on such short acquaintance.
But we've known one another for years.
Well, he doesn't know that.
He must. I just told him.
I mean before that.
Before what?
Care to give me a hand here?
I wouldn't touch this conversation with a 10-foot pole.
Why? I don't follow you.
You just answered your own question.
I beg your pardon?
Here now, silly little thing. Wandering in the middle of the fields in England in the middle of a thunderstorm at night.
With some sherry help?
Help me what?
Warm up, dear.
I'm trying, can't you see?
Dora, I was merely finishing a question, not giving an order.
Dearest, you can't order them to give you a sherry.
Let me get it before we die of thirst.
Oh, Wartsy, you're so thoughtful.
What did you call him?
Wartsy, it's a sort of pet name.
For a toad, perhaps.
But surely you remember why I used to call you that, Barnaby.
Can't say as I do.
But how could you forget? You have the cutest little warts, 3 of them on the back of your right ear. I used to fondle them while riding piggyback.
Oh, those. Got rid of the beastly little thing.
What? Remove your legacy.
Dora, really, stop pestering the poor man.
But if he's had them taken off, whatever am I going to call him henceforth?
Barnaby would be nice.
Barnaby always was nice, especially to me. No one else ever got to ride him piggyback.
Nobody else wanted to.
I dare say that's true. And they would have looked silly, being adults.
Here, now, come back to the fire before you catch pneumonia.
Oh, but Jeff, how will I explain your presence to Grand Uncle Orion?
There's no need. It's already been taken care of. He believes that I'm the short acquaintance of your cousin Cleo.
Nonsense! You're over 6 feet tall!
The acquaintance is short. I'm not.
Well, you should tell Great Uncle Orion at once. No point in confusing you over here.
He's confused.
I say, what's this?
What's what?
Your front page, Mr. Barnett. Picture on the front page of the paper.
Really? How delightful!
Picture of me? What do you mean?
Mr. Jeffrey Barnett, a recent arrival to our shores, deplanes at the London Airport. Mr. Barnett is a noted police reporter with the Dover, Delaware Gazette, but insisted to this reporter that he is here merely for pleasure, not business. By heavens, this explains what Lady Barbara meant earlier.
Great Uncle Barbara? And about what?
She commented earlier that his pictures didn't do him justice. We assumed she thought he was some motion picture actor or some such, but she didn't see the addition of the paper.
But how could she have? It only just arrived a short while ago and had no time to read it.
I dare say that's the truth, and she did say pictures, plural, and there's only the one in the paper.
Perhaps she meant the snapshots I sent her last month in my regular bi-weekly letter.
Snapshots of me?
Of us, darling, on the night of our engagement party.
Oh, congratulations are in order?
Oh, hardly, Wartsy. Mailing the letter is a minor achievement at best.
I meant on the engagement.
That's supposed to be a secret!
Darling, I didn't tell him.
Well, he can't be psychic.
something.
Oh, what does it matter? Fact is, I do know now, and I should like to toast to soon to be bride.
Here now. What's going on with your drink?
It does look a bit odd now that you mention it.
Oh, look, there's a little fly on the rim of the glass.
It's taking a sip.
It's falling onto the table.
It's clutching its throat.
It's rolling onto its back. Oh, Jeffrey, my darling. Hold me.
It's all right. It's over now.
Do you know? It reminds me of my late father.
Your father had six legs?
Certainly not.
Then I don't see the resemblance.
I mean, when he drinks sherry, he'd take a sip, clutch his throat, roll onto his back.
He died of drinking sherry?
Indirectly. He used to drink straight from the bottle, and one night he choked on the cork.
But who put something in the drink? Neither one of y'all went near that decanter, and I certainly put no prejudice in my drink.
Of course you didn't, dear Barnaby. Why, you wouldn't hurt a fly.
That fly is most certainly dead. I don't know, but somebody did put something in your drink. It doesn't make any sense. But I do think you should have it analyzed.
But where would we get a psychiatrist?
Sure, for the love of...
Anyway, besides the point, who would put something in my drink? I don't understand why. We need to figure it out.
Perhaps it's something to do with the tontine.
What tontine?
What tontine? Darling, we had no idea there was a tontine until you said something. At least I didn't.
I certainly didn't. I wouldn't be if I wanted it anyway. Isn't that one of those things where all the people get together, pull all the money, and the survivor takes all? I'd hardly be invited. I'm practically penniless.
That's true, darling. Barnaby comes from a long line of famous paupers.
That's why I went off to America to make my fortune.
And?
Yeah, by the time I got there, all available fortunes had been made. Say that again.
Oh, what a pity.
But yet somebody did try to bump you off. But it doesn't make any sense.
That's it.
That's what?
Don't you see? If the murder attempt didn't make any sense, then to find the murderer, all we have to do is look for a person who doesn't make sense. Jeff, Barnaby, why are you looking at me that way?
It's nothing, Dora. Nothing at all.
Anyway, I don't understand why somebody would try to kill me. I'm the only ones that stand to gain anything if the others die. They stand to gain nothing if I do.
Gain? What do you mean?
I mean, if all five persons died, that wouldn't matter.
It would certainly matter to me, being one of the five.
I mean, matter money-wise. If all five persons died, the money would revert to the estate, and then the soul's surviving relative would inherit everything.
That's suspicious. But, darling, who are the members of the Tontine that you mentioned?
Well, let me see. Great-grandfather Carlo, he's hanging over the fireplace, set the thing up shortly before I died and he went to America. Or was it vice versa? Well, anyhow, the members include Great Uncle Orion, Lady Barbara, Cleo Barton, Miss Barnsdale, and myself. Whoever outlives the others gets the money, and I'm the youngest. Isn't that keen?
Darling, I hate to dampen your spirits, but has it occurred to you that a survivor member of the Tontine might prove a temptation to a poisoner?
Well, we need to figure this out pretty quick. You know, that's got me thinking. That's not a good idea. Well,
what is? What have you thought of?
Well, if my suspicions should prove true, then I can't betray our confidence.
But your confidence could be a killer.
Barnaby, can you tell us without naming names?
Well, if my suspicions should prove true, then I could name names.
stop trying to clear your conscience and tell us what you know?
Well, as a matter of fact, two of the people at this party are imposters.
Three, if you count Jeff, short acquaintance of Cleo and Dee. Or are you counting Jeff?
No, that does make three.
Please tell us what you know, and who are the two imposters?
I can't say, old man. I gave my word and all.
If you ever hope to be an old man, stop trying to ease your conscience and forget what you told your confidant and tell us.
Darling, shouldn't he tell us before he forgets?
That's not what I meant.
But that's what you said.
Dora?
Shh!
Now, as I was saying, tell me, who are the two imposters?
Oh, very well. The two imposters are...
shot from a cannon.
Well, he must have gone someplace because he's definitely not here.
But do you not see how his disappearance is impossible?
Eat this thing!
please tell me? It is very important.
Rosalind and I were taking a stroll after dinner in the garden.
Well, Magnolia and I were finishing up the dishes after dinner.
And I was in the cellar looking for an after-dinner liqueur.
And I was in the dining room dawdling over my dinner.
And I always take a nap after dinner.
Well, Dora, what does that mean?
We've missed dinner!
Wish to give offense to anyone present this evening, but there has been a ghastly murder that has been committed here tonight. And before the police arrive, I think it's with everyone's best interest that we do all that we can to find out who the murderer is and what the motive was. Do you agree? Well, do you? I certainly would feel a lot safer if I knew which one of you to avoid.
Well, and so would I.
Yes, by all means, let's find out who murdered Barnaby.
What I'd like to know is who murdered Barnaby.
Who said that?
Blast. Between your eyes and Barbara's ears, we'll never get anything cleared up.
Then we may as well go to bed.
With the murderer on a prowl.
Magnolia, the locks on these doors are quite stunning.
What if he's in a room with you and you lock it?
Who's to say the murderer is a he? Might be a woman, you know.
Impossible. Barnaby was stabbed. A lady always uses poison. It's much more polite.
But the first attempt on Barnaby's life was a glass of poison.
So there may be two murderers in our midst. A poisoner and a stabber.
I wish you wouldn't say things like that!
Be calm, Magnolia. Rosalind's mistake. The most we could have in our midst is one actual murderer and one would-be murderer, you see? The dagger worked, but the poison didn't.
If you think you've suited my nerve, you're dumber than your look.
Magnolia, that is no way to speak to one's employer.
If you continue, you'll agree with me!
Would you two stop bickering? This constant argument is getting nowhere.
I quite agree with Jeff. It's a little bit too much, and I would really like to know which one of you to avoid.
Us? Why are you excluding yourself?
Why, for what he wrote down was B-A-R. There is no B-A-R in my name, or Magnolia's, or Madam's here.
Oh, that's right. What a relief. I'd feel just terrible if Jeff felt he had to avoid me.
Well, now, wait a minute. I've done some questioning after the murder, and I find that suspicion is much more wider than I first anticipated.
But how can it be? Dear old Wardsey quite definitely wrote B-A-R before he died, so the killer could only be someone like Miss Barstow.
Or Miss Barton.
Well, what about Wardsey?
Oh, don't forget Orion is a baronet.
Don't forget Barbara has two strikes against her.
Barbara, darling, it's your turn.
Should we all be trying to find out who killed Barbara?
It's no use, Dora. She'll never be able to find anything out. But in our catalog of suspects, let's not forget Mr. Barnett himself.
Who tricked me into bringing him up to the house?
Who concealed his engagement to Dora?
And who was alone with Barnaby when he died?
Oh, but Dora was with him, Barnsey.
why we could not be excluded from this list. There is no B-A-R in either one of our names or titles.
Ah, but you were the person tending bar, as it were. You could have easily introduced the poison into the glass.
But I never went nowhere near that sideboard, bought more glass!
But a quick phone call to the agency led to the interesting suspicion that you were only working as a maid for the party to earn enough money to finish attending law school. So in other words, you tend to be a member of the bar.
Aha! We only have their word for it that at the time of the murder, they were washing up the dinner dishes. If they're both under suspicion, a man and a woman, quite easily, a stabber and a poisoner, and quite naturally an alibi could be faked.
Ah, but so could all your alibis, I'm afraid, Mr. LeDuc. For instance, you and Miss Barstow claim to have been strolling in the garden after the murder had occurred. But really? Now in the middle of a thunderstorm? And Miss Barnsdale claims to have been in the cellar looking for after a dinner liqueur, but we all know that she can't read the labels. And Miss Cleo claimed to have been dawdling over dinner because she couldn't abide the boiled mutton and went to her room early for an after-dinner smoke.
But what about Barbara? She always does take a nap after dinner.
No, wait. As we were going into dinner, she said she'd already had the nap.
So you see, there is no one in this room that is above suspicion.
Oh, Jeff!
I didn't mean you, dearest.
And why not? The only account we have of this murder is what the two of you have told us. How do we know that you two can pair up to bump him off and then make up this whole story just to confuse us all?
Because I'm your own flesh and blood, and Jeff has an honest face.
He has. Well, let me just
think
about this.
Well, what has that to do with anything?
Yes, what? We merely suspect him of murder. We never said he was dishonest.
Why are we all standing up? Oh, someone please tell her what's going on.
Who's got a pencil and paper?
Ye gods, are we going to spend all night writing everything down for the old dodo? Orion, darling, I get... Where did he go?
Excuse me. Then what are we looking for?
Orion, dear.
Has anybody seen him?
Did he possibly go out to the garden?
No, the garden's doors are still shut. No, we don't have them. And he can barely walk, so we know he didn't run.
I hate him. No, no, he had to go for all too fast to get by one of us.
And we would have seen him. I swear to that.
Well, he's not simply vanished, darling.
You forgot what happened to Barnaby.
Wait, what happened to Barnaby?
He vanished. He was standing right there by the table when all at once the lights went out. When they came back on, he was gone.
Why didn't you mention this before?
It seemed like a minor occurrence given what happened afterwards.
Yes, a disappearance is nothing compared to a murder.
So it simply slipped my mind.
What mind?
Magnolia!
Why should I be respectful? I was hired for a party, and now the party's over!
Jeff, Thorpe, tell us more about this vanishment before Barnaby was killed.
He was extremely skilled.
Barbara, what are you saying?
Oh, that Barnaby was skilled. She misunderstood Orion's fiancé.
Rosalind, do you mean that you and Orion
talk back to Mason Remedios?
Magnolia, I would hardly call Orion of December 8th.
Or did
how dare you?
That is enough, Magnolia. That
murder to be solved, remember?
Jeff is quite right. Come, let's all sit down and pull together whatever information we have.
Quite right. Now, let's get matters straight. First off, Barnaby was murdered, and probably by someone in this house.
Well, now wait a minute. What's to prevent some outsider from some roving lunatic from just walking and stumbling into the house?
Possible. At this point, Ray, there would have been wet and muddy footprints all over the place. Right, Jeff?
Absolutely. Besides, the killer had to have known the layout of this house.
What made you say that?
Because of the subtle way the poison was introduced to the glass, and the way he disappeared. I mean, who knows? There may be secret panels and such inside this house that we don't know about. How would an outsider know it?
Then it's settled. We can rule the outsider out.
No. What is to prevent some stray madman from coming into the house and stumbling upon these panels or whatnot, and then doing his little deed?
What? Madmen aren't selective in their murders, but Barnaby was definitely singled out to be the victim.
Because otherwise, the poisoner would have been poisoning all three glasses. Is that what you mean, Monty?
Exactly. And since it was the poison in just the one, it was just for Barnaby. Perhaps the madman just didn't have enough poison to go around.
But he did have a dagger, dear. He could have used that more than once.
So then it comes back to Barnaby. It always comes back to Barnaby.
So if we can deduce why Barnaby was murdered.
But we can't. That's a bewildering part of the whole thing. He had no money. He wasn't a member of the Tom team. And it certainly can't be something he knew about any of us, because he hadn't been in touch with any of us for years and years.
Now wait, Dora. He did know something, remember? He said that two of the people in this house were imposters.
Hey, what?
You didn't mention that.
Did he say which two?
That's the whole problem. He was just about to tell us when it happened. The murder.
It's also odd. So decidedly odd. So topsy-turvy.
What is?
The motive. I mean, as the poor relation of the family, Barnaby had a marvelous reason for killing all of us. But none of us has a single reason for wanting him dead.
But we must have.
I certainly don't.
I know what Cleo means. Barnaby's murder is a fact. And murders have to have a motive. So if we can find the motive, we can...
And only one of us knows that motive. We're all showing total ignorance. Honest ignorance in most cases. But only one of us is play acting.
He was very good at it, you know.
Good at what, Aunt Barbara? Who?
Pay her no mind. Orion told me during dinner that she thinks that her and Barnaby used to...
What is it, Barnsey?
Miss Barnsdale, young man. Pet names on such short acquaintance are quite rude.
Oh, come off it, Barnsey. To heck with protocol, we're seeking a killer.
Yes, Barnsey, please, tell us what do you know?
Well, the most fascinating notion just popped into my head that Barnaby and...
What?
Well, I just can't remember.
Oh, no!
extraordinary experience. See, I'm right off down that bench. When all at once, I say, what's become of Monty?
We were hoping you could tell us.
See, Uncle Orion, she seems to have vanished.
Vanished? Bonzi?
Yes, she was standing right in the same spot that I'm standing in, and then all of a sudden she just, oh dear.
Thank you. Hi, I'm Gary, owner of Young Ideas. We'd like to take this time to let you know a little bit about Young Ideas. If you're looking for TV service for your locally owned business, please reach out to us. Also, if you're looking for service for your home, we can help you there as well. From dish TV service to sling TV service to internet to on the go with Dish Outdoors, we have you covered. Just simply come down to our showroom at 584 North 4th Street in Wills Point and shop locally. We hope to see you soon. Oh, I almost forgot. Don't forget to check out our Google Smart Home products. Hey, Wills Point, are you ready to get more from your TV? With Dish Communities and Young Ideas, your authorized premier local dish retailer, you can now get ready to watch Friday Night Lights from WPISD directly on your Hopper 3. Simply go to the Dish Communities tabs, select on the channel you want to watch, Wills Point ISD, and get ready for your Friday Night Football.
watching. There are also going to be some live tickets available for that, so you can, they'll be the same ticket price. So if you'd like to come and just watch the radio show, you'll get to see us do the same thing basically without costumes and stuff. And how well we can read, or they can read. Okay, I think we're about ready to start our second. Thank you.
My fault, all of us. If I hadn't been so greedy.
What? And you do know something. Tell us quick before something else happens.
Well, you see, the reason I invited the family and everyone home together at Margate was.
Not bigger about proper wording, and what is the significance of these doodads that are so important?
Why, they each hold
before he died, of course.
The father?
Uncle Orion's father was my great-grandfather, Rosalind. His name was Barlow. He was ever so nice.
Never
mind
that.
That's why Uncle had him painted and hung.
I said never mind that. I want to know the significance of these gizmos.
John? What? What's these?
Pigeon fingers.
What a fun day. What's become of your nice chain with a little lab rabbit on it?
I told you, shut up! Not another word. Do not say one more thing. That's better. Now, please explain to me these limericks. Consart, I didn't need you to be silent forever.
Well, my Jesus, I was on the acting side.
Several strange disappearances, and now some apparent theft of these doodads of vast importance. We all may be in hideous peril, and all you people can seem to do is babble at me.
Babble?
What babble?
It all makes perfect sense to me.
All right, then, you explain it.
Which part?
Ah! Hooey!
I'm just as befuddled as Jeff is, and I'm going to go a lot longer.
There's nothing easy about being on the stage. Why, I remember Miss Michaels always telling me, how very difficult it was to play a role like that Mr. Tate, or Lawson. You know, the one from Hanover Station.
Who?
She's talking about Barnaby, old chap. She never did get his name right, but then again, she hardly ever gets anything right.
She seems to think that they were on the stage together.
Aunt Barbara and Barnaby? But how silly!
Oh, please, we're getting completely off track. What was that blather about a limerick?
Oh, that was a clue to where father had left the gold.
Aha! Now we're getting somewhere. What gold?
Why, our gold, of course. You see, darling, Uncle Orion, Aunt Barbara, Cleo, Barnsley, and myself all converted whatever cash we had into gold for that donkey. Then great-grandfather took it and hid it.
Oh, that was a nasty trick. Oh, but you don't understand. We asked him to do it.
Hide your gold? Whatever for?
So we wouldn't know where it was, of course.
Perhaps I'm the crazy one.
Oh, not at all. It sounds equally as stupid to me.
Well, what could be simpler? When we first bought the gold, it was a mere $35 an ounce. Nowadays, of course, it's worth a small fortune.
A large fortune, Orion. Gold has to be at least 20 times as much now.
But great-grandfather didn't want any of us to come into temptation, so...
Temptation to what?
Why, to cash in our fortune early, don't you think?
He suspected that the price of gold would rise and didn't want us to... be able to cash it in before it had reached its utmost limits.
But if we found it, of course, we would have before it did. And it wouldn't have the chance to.
My mind must be going. I'm beginning to understand Dora.
But what does all this have to do with the limerick?
Darling, a limerick has five lines, and there were five of us. So we each got a single line of it.
It's all starting to make sense now. Your uncle hid the gold and gave each one of you five lines of the limerick. And none of you can get to it without the help of the other.
Good grief, so that's it.
Now do you see why I was so upset at losing my pigeon thingy?
John Bull.
You mean the lines of the limericks were in your jumble? But, you mean they were both stolen? Or have you lost yours, you say?
I did not lose mine, young man.
You mean you still have it?
Well, no, but I didn't lose it. It was taken by force.
Barnsley, don't be such a pedant. What he means is, you've had it, and now you don't.
Then the killer will have two clues to the whereabouts of the gold.
Three, now that Cleo's missing.
And he needs all five.
Well, he shan't get mine. I wouldn't hear of such a thing.
I assume you kept it in a safe place.
Of course I have. I very cleverly had it attached to this trap bracelet.
they'll be talking to the wall to make her understand anything.
Of course, it is the duty of the butler to pour the sherry, but these are difficult times, and I guess one should make do.
There's one already poured.
Oh, there's one already poured. You needn't bother.
Just drink your drink and shut up.
Thank you, dear. My, what a peculiar color.
What's wrong with the color?
And a peculiar outdoor, too.
Well, I wouldn't know. I'm lucky to afford, and my wages, I'm lucky to afford a pot of piss.
Jitters? Oh, I guess we all have them. You know, the murder and all. Huh? It does tend to dampen one's party spirits.
Memorized yours.
Well, of course I did, darling. I'm an actress.
so we can all put them together.
Well, what about Barbara's? What's the matter? You're all looking at me as if I'd hiccuped in church.
Perhaps the rest of you have enough. What was yours, Orion?
Well, let's see. To the best of my recollection, it's... They must look for a place.
Yes, go on.
Well, that's it, old chap.
That's all of it?
Well, maybe it will make sense with all the others, Jeff.
Well, I certainly hope so. What was yours?
Wants to pull out the gold sugar plums.
That sounds like gibberish.
Well, let's give it a chance. Barnsey?
Miss Barnsdale.
Come off it, Barnsey. Our very lives may depend on this.
Very well. When a family that's truly all thugs,
what about them?
Well, that's it.
That's what? You mean that was your line of the limerick?
Of course.
Last, you could have said so.
May we have it again from the beginning, please?
When a family that's truly all thumbs. There, are you satisfied?
It's still not making any sense. We only knew the order of the lines.
Oh, we know that, all right.
You do? But how?
Well, Father said he was handing the things out in order, you see.
And what was that order?
Well, let's see. It was Barnsey, Cleo, myself, Dora, and Barbara.
How can you be so certain, dearest?
Well, you see, Father said he did it that way so we wouldn't forget. Something old, something new, something borrowed, something blue, and Barbara.
Dare he call me old?
Well, Barnsey, you are the oldest. You were my governess. Leo's governess and Dora's governess.
Never mind about all that. I want to know why I was something new.
Well, you see, you had just gotten your first nose job.
Oh, Lee!
Bloody God!
Oh, shut up, you little gold digger.
Sticks and stones may break my bones. Don't tempt me.
Ladies, there is a murder to be solved, remember?
Jeff's right. Let me finish. Something borrowed was my title of baronet since it wasn't rightfully mine until Father kicked off.
Just to look, Duke, how you memorize the order of the bestowals hardly matters.
Please let me finish, Jeff. I want to know why I was something blue. Was it my lovely blue eyes?
Well, no, my dear, you see. When your parents were expecting you, they were so certain that you were going to be a boy that they ordered all the baby clothes of the wrong color.
But when she was born, why didn't they make an exchange?
Rosalind, that's monstrous!
Of the clothes, boy.
Not of you! Listen, all of you, any minute now the killer could strike again, and all you people can seem to do is babble about baby clothes and nose jobs and...
Jeffrey is quite right. Here, let's start again from the top. I'll begin.
When a family that's truly all thumbs
wants to pull out the gold sugar plums.
They must look for a place.
Showing my smiling colon.
Oh, that is absolutely disgusting.
A terrible rhyme.
Dora, are you sure that's what it says?
Oh, now I see. I hadn't unfolded this one little bit. There, now it makes sense.
What does it say?
I can't read it now. The rhythm will be spoiled.
For God's sakes.
Oh, Jeff, perhaps we should just do it her way. It's always best to give her a nut, you know.
Who are you calling a nut?
It's a straight jacket.
It's no use. She hasn't the foggiest notion. We'll have to write it down for her.
I know there's half a pencil in here someplace. Let me see now. Ink, stapler, ruler, eraser, paperweight.
Ooh, ooh, I found Nickin. He came back just as I was sweeping up.
I didn't know he was lost.
Oh, Magnolia, have you found Nickins yet?
Yes, Mom, I have.
Why were you looking for him?
Because he disappeared so mysteriously, sir.
What? When?
When we were putting the dinner dishes away, Mom. He stepped into the pantry, and when I looked, he was gone.
But when exactly was that?
Just before that mysterious gunshot. That made Lottie's arm was full of poison drink.
Wait, how do you know her drink was poisoned?
Well, I did. Not at the time. But I recognized its color. It was the same shade as that green.
But once you did know of the poison, why didn't you tell anyone?
Because I thought it was some sort of sauce, son.
You're barking a false, sir. I hope it wasn't a good china.
Barbara, hush, Bob.
Come again.
Magnolia, you're not making any sense. What has the poison got to do with Medkin's disappearance?
Well, when he was coming out of the pantry when I went into the kitchen, he was carrying a small bottle. No, a flask. No, it was too small for that. A vial.
Oh, just say container and get on with your story.
Fine, Mom. Container. And it filled with the green poison.
Look, you're still not making sense. So you say you saw Medkins, and he was carrying a container. And the container was filled with green liquid. And you think it's the same liquid that was in Lady Barbara's drink. But you still haven't said how you know it's poison.
Well, that was the same stuff put on the horse's tooth.
Hors d'oeuvre.
Sorry, sir.
So if you poison the horse's tooth, I need the hors d'oeuvres. How could you be certain?
Because I just ate one.
Well, then go barefoot, Barnsley. Nobody would mind.
I would mind.
new police station is at the far end of the village.
Ah, but the village is scarcely a mile wide. They could have easily walked here by now.
It is puzzling. I mean, Orion, did they give any indication of a delay whenever you phoned them?
Well, as a matter of fact, I did it to give them a ring. I was too busy helping Jeffrey carry Barnaby's body up the stairs. I asked Rosalind to call.
Oh, I was too busy helping Cleo get over her mistakes, so I asked Laura to call them.
But I was busy helping Magnolia clean the glasses and things about the room.
So you didn't call them?
Now, Jeff, would I overlook an important thing like that?
Yes!
Well, I didn't, so there.
Didn't overlook it, or didn't call them?
Didn't overlook it, of course.
So you did call?
Well, no.
Then what?
Why, I asked Medkins to call them.
Dora, you dunce! Medkins is the murderer!
Well, I didn't know that then.
But once you did know that, why didn't you say something?
Because we all found out at the same time, darling. There was no need.
Not about the killer, you lunatic.
About not calling the police.
Well, now we can't be certain he didn't phone them.
Why not?
Because he hadn't been exposed as the murderer yet. And calling the police would be a part of his cover, you see.
I better call them. It's funny, the phone is dead.
That is not funny.
I didn't mean that kind of funny.
Don't worry, darling. At least we have you here.
I'd rather we had the police.
Well, he is a police reporter. It's practically the same thing.
Yes, it is not. Police arrest criminals. Reporters just write about them.
Well, at least he has a pistol.
That reminds me. Where did you get that pistol anyhow?
I found it in one of the drawers of the desk. So overstuffed that you can find anything in there.
Except a pin. Oh, do you know? That's giving me an idea.
Oh, that's the best time for everything. Rosalind, no need to be rude.
Dora isn't totally stupid, you know.
No, she merely asks the murderer to fetch the police.
Cleo, meeting so soon?
Well, it's not soon enough for me. I'm not sticking around to be the next victim.
Oh, you shouldn't carry your own bags. You should ask a servant.
Which servant? The killer or the corpse?
Speaking of servants, what's become of Magnolia's body?
Why? We laid it down right over there on the bench.
I could have sworn I saw a corpse over there. That was me. That was I.
They're both corpses?
Something very interesting about that painting. Shouldn't they be facing the other way?
Now that you mention it, it does look backwards.
Well, they don't stick out like a sore thumb in this group.
Well, Cleo, don't go yet. We need your Bentley.
What for?
To go fetch the police.
You mean to tell me that they won't come unless I drive them?
Oh, Cleo, you don't understand. The phone is dead, and every little Dora over there didn't phone the police.
But I did ask Medkins to do so.
She's not dopey, she's demented. I'm getting out of here.
Could you at least stop by the police station on your way?
Look, darling, when I go through those doors, I am putting my foot down on the accelerator, and I'm not stopping until I'm safe in my own bed.
Oh, who knows? She has a drive-in bedroom.
Look, I've had about enough of that!
Hold it!
I am holding, darling.
How dare you call him that?
I'm a movie star. I call everybody, darling.
And we're back to the drive-in bedroom.
Well, at least I don't have to marry for money.
Don't talk, Brock. Cleo, Rosalind said she'd have me if I were penniless.
Have you shot me?
Now, there's a very good reason why you can't leave just yet.
And what reason would that be?
Well, it's just that Barnaby did say that there were two imposters at this party. We know that Medkins is one of them,
I might be the other?
Anyone could be the other.
Except
Barnaby wrote B-A-R on the desk, you immediately assumed it stood for Rosalind Barstow, that you never trusted her.
Well, I like that.
I'm so glad you're not upset. But, darling, why shouldn't I have said that?
Because, if matters stand correctly, you said that you never even saw her before tonight.
Aha!
On the other hand, Mr. LeDuc, you and Miss Barstow claim to have been dawdling in the gardens during the murder, but we both know you weren't.
Aha!
And you claim to have been dawdling over after dinner into your room for a smoke.
Aha!
And you claim to have been reading wine cellar labels, but you weren't.
Aha! Lord Havisham put the caliber in the punch bowl. I knew it all the time.
And finally, we have Lady Barbara's supposed nap.
Well, we can hardly ask her about it.
Oh, yes, we can. I am going to go over there, and I'm going to write down every last word and show it to the old girl. We'll get to the bottom of this.
Thank you, Theo. I appreciate the favors.
Oh, honey, I have favors I haven't even used yet.
Now that is funny.
Now, tell me all of your true stories, please.
I already did trust Rosalind before I met her, because Aunt Barbara wrote me of her in her semi-monthly letters.
Rosalind and I weren't out in the garden because...
We were snitching under the terrace overhang.
I left the dining room to go to the restroom because I needed to, and I was just too shy to tell anybody.
And I was in the cellar, lost in the passageway, so I couldn't see very well, and I was too embarrassed to say something.
And I had to go upstairs to take off my corset because it was killing me, and I'm too much of a lady to admit.
I guess that does account for some things.
Don't be too downhearted, darling. After all, this is your first case.
Yes, Jeff, darling, don't worry too much. There are still oodles of things that require explanation.
Such as?
Well, why was the gun fired into the ceiling? Why did Medkins poison the hors d'oeuvre before he learned Lady Barbara signed on the limerick? Why did Orin invite us here anyway? And why is Lady Barbara's last name Fenwick if she is the wife of Mr. LeDuc's brother? And why is Barnaby's name Falsey if he is the son of the same LeDuc? And if so, doesn't that make him Lady Barbara's son too? And finally, what was that fascinating notion that popped into Monty's head just before she vanished?
How many puzzles does that make now?
I make it 7.
No, Uncle. There were 7 questions, so you make it 8.
Yes, Dora, I'm not a puzzle.
Only in regards to his taste in women.
Why, you know it! Never!
Don't hold it!
Ladies, stop this. Let's find out who the murderer is first. Then you can kill each other.
Quite right. Now, first question in order. Why was that bullet fired into the ceiling?
To startle Lady Barbara into spilling her drink so that she would not drink the poison because he hadn't gotten the last line of the liver.
But then why poison the hors d'oeuvre? That might have done her in.
Because hors d'oeuvre are all ham and caviar and anchovy, and I'm on a salt-free diet.
Now, why did Orion invite you all this evening?
Well, my motive was entirely selfish. You see, times are rough, taxes are up, and dissolving the Tontine was the only possible source of money for me.
And you needed all 4 lines of the limericks.
Well, that makes sense. Not to me.
What else is there?
Now, why is Lady Barbara's shirt name Fenwick if she was married to a LeDuc?
told him.
Oh, how marvelously simple.
You certainly are.
Now, Barnes, what was that notion that popped into your head?
Well, let's see. It has something to do with Barbara and her acting classes. No, I'm sorry. It just slipped right out of my mind whenever my John Bull was stolen. Perhaps I'll remember that.
Well, now that we've answered all those questions, I think I'll just be on my way.
Wait, there's still one more minor mystery. Whatever became of Magnolia's body?
Yes, what did happen to it? Now, she was right there at the bench, and I'm so certain that she was marked dead. But if no one came up to this bench and dragged her off, we would have noticed.
Well, you see, it's on a turntable. It swivels around into the wall.
Why didn't you tell us this before?
Well, I didn't know until it happened to me.
You mean you swished yourself? The killer didn't do it?
But how could he have? Medkins was right in the room and it occurred.
Well, I can't believe it.
That Medkins was in the room?
That you made a sensible statement.
But once you did swish into the room and accidentally activated this mechanism, what happened then?
Well, it's kind of fuzzy. I found myself in a dark passageway, and I was wandering around trying to find my way out when someone hit me on the back of the head, tied me up, and popped me back out into the room.
There's only one thing to do. I have to activate this and find out where Metcalf is in the room.
Wait a minute. What if you get back there and he's not there?
Why, then Jeff will come back out, of course. Won't you, darling?
If I can figure out how to work this thing. Whoops.
There has to be a body there.
Oh, you would be a lousy decorator.
I just had another thought. Crazy thought. What? He had our only weapon. What if Medkins comes back in here right now?
I'll call for the police. Oh. Hello? 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 I'm looking for the killer.
I'll run for help.
Oh, just stop. I'll go for the police. It's going to be our only hope.
Oh, wait. I'll go with you. You don't know where the new police station is.
Aren't you afraid we'll tear each other's hair out?
It beats getting stabbed.
You have a point there.
It's so nice to be home again. Nothing this exciting ever happens in Delaware.
That's it! That's what I forgot when I got grabbed!
How dull it is in Delaware?
No. That Barnaby had spent all those years in America, but he didn't know that Dover was its capital.
Oh, he didn't know his nickname was Wartsy either, come to think of it.
And he told you when he was done that there were two imposters at this party.
Great Godfrey, you know what I mean.
That Metcalf was one, and
Barnaby was the other.
Oh, how clever you are. I must tell Jeff the good news. How do you work this thing anyway? I think I've got it. What is this? You're not Jeff.
Who is it?
Oh, it's only Medkins. Medkins?
It is Medkins.
Oh, Medkins. Might I trouble you for a glass of sherry?
You may not. You, over there, sit down. All of you, sit down. Keep your hands where I can see you.
Then how about some gin?
Listen here, you old fool.
Wartsy!
What? No.
But I know those warts, all three of them. You're not Medkins at all. You're Cousin Barnaby.
That's the answer to the puzzle. We always were trying to figure out why anybody would bump off Barnaby. Come to find out, they didn't.
Well, then who was the other chap who got murdered?
Why, that was an actor that I hired to play me. But then he got a little bit
dash it, all your credentials, ma'am. The agency brought you to my door in an agency automobile.
Yes, that was another accident I hired. Driving me up here in as a chauffeur.
But Barnaby, what was the point of it all?
Don't you understand? I needed the money. You all had the money. When I showed up here like 2 days ago, found out there was no money. I had to wait for this blasted taunting to come together.
But you're still not making sense. If the police thought you were dead, and you had murdered us all, then there'd still be no way for you to obtain the inheritance.
See, I thought of that. When the police showed up, there would be a will, and everything would go to my heir.
What heir?
Why, Joshua Frobisher from far away Phoenix.
Who is that?
Don't you see? I am Joshua Frobisher.
But wouldn't you be recognized when you came to collect the cash?
Of course not. I would hire another actor to go get it for me.
Boy, equity would be just crazy about you.
You certainly have overcomplicated things quite exceedingly.
Not at all. You don't know what it's like. Always being the pauper, the poor one of the rich bunch. You know what it takes to get money out of all of you? Always being left flat broke. Now, wait. Where's Cleo and Rosalind?
I say, I just realized something. Since the two imposters that Barnaby, that is the actor you hired, the two imposters you were trying to name were you and himself, and that means that
when he wrote B A R,
he was trying to spell out Barnaby.
B A R stood for Barnaby. We never even considered he might be writing his own name.
Even if he had completed the name, we would be more confused than ever.
Not to Dora, she had already reached her limit.
Now, Uncle Orion, this is no time for compliments.
Oh, never mind. The important thing is, what do you plan to do with this now, Barnaby or Meekins?
Well, that's quite easy. I get the rest of your little limericks, kill you all, take the money, and live happily ever after.
You won't get away with it. Any moment now, Jack will come back here.
Everyone, I have news. Barnaby is Meekins, and Meekins is the murderer. Oh, fudge.
My poor doctor, did he hurt you?
Get away from him!
Oh, don't be so grouchy. What does it matter if he's tied up or not? You're gonna kill us anyway.
Yeah, good point. Okay, again, where are Cleo and Rosalind?
Oh, they've just gone to fetch the police.
What?
Now, you needn't worry. You can murder us all and make your getaway in plenty of time.
Rosalind.
all going, where shall I hide it? Where shall I hide it? Where shall I hide it?
It was enough to make anybody scream.
Yes, it's no wonder he told her to stick it in her ear.
Stick it in her ear!
So that's it. It must be it.
It's got to be it.
Of course it is.
You don't seriously mean she actually stuck it in her ear? That would be crazy.
And this family who'd notice. But how long has she been deaf, Orient?
Well, since the day Father passed away.
Oh, do you suppose?
Well, you know, it was quite a shock. Of course, we all thought it was because of his death, but...
Shock? What shock? He was 97 years old.
Still in all, it must have been a shock to him.
Theo, Rosalind, you're not dead. How are you not dead? I give it the brakes.
Obviously, not well enough.
Oh, you did a dandy job.
Then how did you stop?
We ran smack in the Barnaby's cottage.
Before you got up to highway speed? How lucky for you.
Where did you live? Where did you stop? My rock garden. No, my penny bush.
No, your living room.
Oh, and I just had the carpets cleaned.
Why did you come back, you fools?
Medkin's plans to kill us all. I mean, Barnaby.
But I thought Barnaby was killed.
No. I am Barnaby.
You are Barnaby?
But who was that who was murdered?
I am not going to visit him.
We'll explain it all after the killer is captured.
Seriously? You, over there with her, please.
And you, Lady Barbara, if you don't mind, lend me your ear.
Stop it! What are you doing?
Getting the last line of the poem.
Now, let's see what it says.
Now I got it.
You know the location of the gold?
Not quite.
Why not?
Because I forgot the first four lines.
Oh, goody, let's not tell him.
But he needs to all five.
Not mine, he hasn't.
Thank you.
Hadn't?
Now, we'll make this easy. Everyone just recite their lines.
After the rude way you yanked that off my wrist?
That's nothing compared to the rude way I'm going to shoot you in the foot.
Dora, better not argue with him.
Who's arguing? My line is...
In order, and no tricks.
When a family that's truly all thumbs
wants to pull out the gold sugar plums,
there's a smoke or a plate.
Showing my smiling face. Colon.
With a tug of a cord, down it comes.
What face?
What cord?
Oh, I'm here. I'm cured. I can hear. I've come back to the wonderful world of sound.
Then hear this. Hush, or I'm going to fly.
Yep. I must admit she did.
And I told you it was that Mr. Tate Lawson. And I told you that too.
You did.
Tonight was merely an actor.